Well, good morning, everyone. A warm welcome is extended to all as we gather here at St. Saviour's today. We hope that you enjoy your time of worship with us, either in person or virtually. Your presence enriches us at this time of celebration together. At this time in our service, we acknowledge birthdays and special anniversaries. And we're aware of one birthday that happened a couple of days ago. Donna DeRitter, happy birthday, Donna. I think she's here. I'm going to ask anybody out with me if, in person, any celebrations that I don't know of that you'd like acknowledged? We got Cheryl last week, but but we can add Cheryl again because you can't ever get too many blessings. Anybody else, anything going on? Then we'll sing the blessing.
May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord.
Our opening hymn is 445, God the Creator. And so we'll use the sentences in your bulletin today. Those who listen, those who seek and hear God speak.
It is in the beauty around us, the whisper of compassion.
God can also work through people. Those who help bring calm in the midst of misery, comfort in the face of misery, kindness instead of more cruelty. With the help of God, we can plead for peace, mercy, justice, and liberty for those who are in need. Acts of gentleness and thoughtful words ensure the message of God's love is heard and lived. And together, Lord of every day, when the road ahead is totally scary or far too comfortable, reveal your life-giving waymarks so that having made them our own, we travel on with risk, vulnerability, vision, awareness, passion, struggle, energy, and compassion as our constant companions. Amen. And please remain seated for the proclamation of the word.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. When the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. He brought it up, and it grew up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and you gave the house of Israel and of Judah, and if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this very sun. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan said to David, "Now the Lord has put away your sin, you shall not die. Listen for the leading of the Spirit."
Thanks be to
God. Our psalm today is taken from Psalm 51, and the refrain is, "Turn from evil and do good." Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses. Wash me through and through from my wickedness and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. And so you are justified when you speak and upright in your judgment. Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth, a sinner from my mother's womb. For behold, you look for truth deep within me, and will make me understand wisdom secretly. Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure. Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed. Make me hear of joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Give me the joy of your saving help again, and sustain me with your bountiful spirit. I shall teach your ways to the wicked, and sinners shall return to you.
And we continue in worship with hymn 511, 511. Lord Jesus, think on me.
To the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of heaven? He who descends is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gift he gave was that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, others teachers, to equip the saints with the work of ministry for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to measure of all full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming, but speak the truth in love. We must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. Listen for the leading of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
And the gradual hymn is 447, Lord, we hear your word with gladness. gladness you have spoken, we rejoice. Words of love and life and freedom, help us make their truth our choice. Now in holy celebration, for your word we worship you. Spoken, written, known in Jesus, ours today to prove anew. May we hear with understanding by your Spirit taught and led. May the springs of all our being by your living word be fed. May our hearts accept with meekness all the grace your light makes known. May obedience mark our footsteps till we make each word our own. You have spoken, yours the fullness, ours the wealth of this your word. Debtors then, as living letters, we must make our gospel heard. By your Spirit's power, transform us, shed your saving light abroad, till our lives by love in action show our world the truth of God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So when the crowd saw neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boat and went to Capernaum, looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has sent his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the work of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gave you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning. So our gospel reading today is from John, and John writes quite differently than Matthew, Mark, and Luke. I learned that Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they often have wrote about events that happened while following Jesus. Whereas John's gospel assumes we already know a lot about Jesus and the things that he did. And so John tends to focus on the meanings behind what Jesus did and the things he spoke about. John seems to be the most reflective of the writers of the gospel. He helps us to understand the basics of our Christian faith. John tells us who Jesus is, lets us know what problems we may face in our lives, and then tells us what to do in order to have everlasting life. Seems pretty simple. As I reflected about today's gospel and what to share, it became apparent to me that the topic of bread is an incredibly important food of today, but it played an important role in the time of Jesus. There are many significant and theological events in the Bible involving the subject of bread. In the Old Testament, for example, Exodus, the trip from Egypt to the Promised Land. The Hebrews, if we recall, were in Egypt in the first place because they needed bread. Their crops of wheat had failed due to no water, and so they migrated to Egypt because there was a surplus of wheat there. So it was bread, or lack of it, actually, that began the chain of events leading to Exodus. Later, as the Jewish people were on their way to the Promised Land, they were facing starvation in the wilderness, and God rained down bread from heaven in the form of manna. I remember seeing the movie Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs. I don't know if anyone ever saw that. But in the movie, it rains meatballs. And I remember seeing it and wondering if that's how it looked when bread fell from heaven. Another important example of bread is when one day Jesus was praying by the side of the road, and his disciples asked him to teach them how to pray. It was in the midst of that prayer that we hear, "Give us this day our daily bread." And so bread is central in so many ways. I love learning how the Bible stories are all connected and interrelated in so many ways, despite so many writers. And as I reviewed some of the commentaries for today's gospel, there was a common theme of searching for something, a common theme about learning about and believing in Jesus, a theme of where and how we look for Jesus, our faith, and the many things that can or do get in our way. And so we learn of searching, a hunger for something, and in John's description, the hunger and the search is for Jesus, who is the bread of life, and how this search can lead us to joy. And I think it's so important because I search for joy. I love joyful things, and I strive each day to add some joy to my life. And in my own life, I think of the journey I've been on, sometimes searching, sometimes not. I grew up attending Sunday school here at St. Xavier's, and I think I pretty much believed everything I was told. I learned that if I was a good person and did good things, and if I believed in God and Jesus, I would go to heaven. In my teenage years, I began to question things a little bit. For example, I remember asking Rick Kondo, "I don't understand how God created the world in 6 days. It sounds impossible." And I recall Reverend Rick explaining that God's version of 6 days did not necessarily line up with my version of 6 days. That made sense to me, and so onward we went. And it was only recently in Bible study that I learned that the birth story of Jesus couldn't have really happened the way it's described. And it was told, and so it's fair to say that the questions and wonderings keep coming. In my early 20s, I got married, and my husband died shortly thereafter, right after we were married. And so I spent quite a few years asking God, how could such a horrible thing happen? I was not only searching for God for answers, but I then decided I wanted nothing to do with him. The why does bad things happen to good people is something I and many people wrestle with. The truth is, and what I've learned over time, is God does not do bad things to good people. God is, in fact, with us wherever we go, through all things, good, bad, or otherwise. It's the faith and the strength that comes from God that, in fact, gets us through these events. I remember quite a few years ago chatting with Janet Andrews, and we remarked, actually she first remarked, how blessed we are to have a faith and a God and a friend in Jesus for when the tough and awful things do happen in our lives. Without that, where would we be? I'm thankful for these conversations as they help us find the search that we're looking through in difficult times. And my journey continued. God puts people and events in our lives, and when we have left him, there is an opportunity to return. I did not attend church during what I call my angry years. However, when Tyler was 3, he's my son, my mom asked if she could bring him to Sunday school, and I thought, sure, go ahead, take him. They, as in my mom and dad, wanted to introduce Tyler to the faith. The first morning my mom came to pick him up, he decided he was not going to church with her unless I agreed to go with him, which turned out was quite an odd thing because he went everywhere with my mom with no concern. This is what I now call a God incidence, where God is experienced in my life, even when I'm not paying attention. God, through Tyler and my mom, brought me back where I am today. The first day I returned to church, I had no intention of making it a habit. However, I have missed very few Sundays since. And I've now worked hard at searching, finding, learning to pray, reading scripture, and enjoying this community and outreach that I'm able to participate in our church family. And I'm very blessed. I was searching and I didn't know I was searching. I was hungry and I didn't know that I was hungry. We live as people in a hungry and searching world. We look for something that will nourish us and sustain us. But we're asked, what kind of bread do we eat? Sometimes we eat the bread of having to get our own way and be right. We can eat the bread of loneliness, resentment, hurt feelings, fear, anxiety, guilt, sorrow. So many things that do not and cannot bring joy. The world is full of nourishing bread, yet many of us live hungry, empty, or searching. In the gospel, the disciples go looking for Jesus after he fed the 5,000. I at first thought they must be looking for him to show how amazed they were at this incredible sign. Instead, they seemed only interested in their own issues and appetites. They were looking for something for themselves. Thankfully, Jesus did not turn them away, even when they were only thinking of themselves. Instead, he shared with them the way of joy, happiness, and eternal life. He shared with them that he is the bread of life, that whoever comes to him will never be hungry, and whoever believes in him will never thirst. We know these are metaphors, but they are important metaphors for our life and our search for love, joy, and fulfillment. The food that endures us is Jesus himself. What the disciples did, only thinking about themselves, is things we've all been guilty of. I know I have. Searching out Jesus more when I need something, praying for needs rather than praying with thanks, even during hard times. We are able to ask and seek from Jesus, but is it important to be thankful for our blessings? And truthfully, no matter what reason people seek Jesus, the search is always a good thing. What matters is not so much where we begin our search or what our motives really are. What matters is where our search takes us and where we end up. Jesus urges us to think about him like eating a piece of bread. He invites us to chew on his teachings and his ministry. He wants his wisdom and his action to be something that comes into our hearts, our minds, and our souls. Jesus wants to become a part of who we are and how we walk through our days. Jesus can be with us while we search and for all the things we need in life. Jesus, the bread of life, can help us in our deepest needs. In the midst of my anxiety, he can help with a calm serenity. If I have a burden of guilt, Jesus ensures a freedom of forgiveness. If I'm weighted down by grief or sadness, I can recover with a spirit of joy. And if I feel empty, Jesus can help me find a sense of purpose. We are more than just physical people who need physical sustenance. We are also spiritual beings, and Jesus is capable of being in the deepest of our soul. And so we're being asked to trust Jesus, to pursue him, to have a relationship with him, and to experience him. And if we allow this, then he is in our hearts, our minds, and our souls. He can bring beautiful things into our lives. Joy will be there. Kindness will be second nature. Hope will be our view. Empathy will be our thinking. Passion will guide us. Justice and fairness and equality will be our place. And we will have love to give to others and receive from others, and that will be our blessing. When we believe in Jesus and we take him into our lives, we have the opportunity to live differently. We see ourselves and one another as equal, as persons created in God's image and in the likeness of God. We trust prayer. We choose love. We choose to listen for God's voice rather than always our own voice. Ultimately, we seek life and joy here on earth. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." He is offering himself to us, just as he did to the disciples in the gospel. And today he makes us this same offer. He offers it to us in all of our relationships, with our family, with our friends, with strangers, and even with our enemies, those we agree with and those we don't. In every situation and every day of our life, we choose the kind of bread we want to eat. And in choosing so, we choose the kind of life we want to live. It enables us to live our best life on earth as we continue to be the gift and the joy and to see God in all people we encounter. And this is in itself joyful. It's the search I will continue on in hopes of deepening my relationship not only with God and Jesus, but with others in my life. Amen. Sorry, Ian. I invite you to stand as we affirm our faith together. In response to the word reflected on, let us share an affirmation of faith. I believe in God's world, in beauty of earth and sky and sea, in sunbeams playing on rippling water, in moon and stars milking the midnight sky. I believe in God's world, in green life pulsing through brown earth, in miracle of bud and flower and fruit, in great trees raising gnarled arms against rain and wind. I believe in God's world, in the cry of a newborn seeking the life-giving breast, in gnarled old age dozing in the sun, in sweating backs bent over unyielding soil. I believe in God's world, in Jesus hung between earth and sky, in the giving of one's life, in the service of humanity. I believe in God's world. Amen.
And we come now to the time of offering, and as I've said a few times, if we're completely in service and back to what we always used to know as the normal, this would be the time that the ushers would come down the aisle with the collection plates and then present them on the altar. And while we're still in pandemic life, there are ways that you can present your cash offerings, and you know what they are. But it's when we offer, it's also a time of offering time and talents. And as I've also said a few times, those can be as simple as just looking after or making a phone call to somebody that you know needs to hear from you. And so I would invite all of us to continue to do that, to find a little time and or a day to phone one or two people, just acknowledge that you're thinking of them and bringing to them some of the joy that Kim just talked about. And so our offering hymn is 85, Shepherd of Souls, Refresh and Bless. Shepherd of souls, refresh and bless your chosen pilgrim flock with manna in the wilderness, with water from the rock. We would not live by bread alone, but by your word of grace, in strength of which we travel on to our abiding place. Be known to us in breaking bread, but do not then depart. Savior, abide with us and spread your table in our heart. Lord, sup with us in love divine, your body and your blood, that living bread, that heavenly wine, be our immortal food. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. And please join with me in the prayer over the gifts. God, our sustainer, accept all we offer you this day, and feed us continually with that bread which satisfies all hunger, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand, sit, or kneel for the prayers of intercession. May we have courage in uncertain times.
Let it all happen. No one is fine.
May we recognize new beginnings in what seem to be endings.
Let it all happen. No feeling is fine.
For the church, the world, and the needs of all people, let us pray to the Lord. God, our loving parent, thank you for giving us the bread we need for body and soul, even when we are estranged from you and from one another. Thank you for Jesus, our life, our bread, our source of unity with you and with each other.
Lord, of your mercy, hear our prayer.
Your church is the body of Christ. Give it unity with him and unity in him. Let your Holy Spirit fashion the church into the likeness of Jesus, so that when it speaks and acts, people hear and see their Savior.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Make us mindful of our union with those who are persecuted for Jesus' sake. Let them know they are not forgotten by you or by the rest of the church. May their faithful witness feed their enemies with the bread of repentance and faith. And where it is the church that has persecuted people, we pray for their healing.
Lord, in mercy, hear our prayer.
Feed the people of this congregation with the living bread of heaven. Nourish us with the cup of blessing from Christ's hand. Help us to know the depth, height, and breadth of your love. Fill us with your Spirit so we can share your love with others.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Thank you for those who maintain food pantries, soup kitchens, community gardens. Thank you for everyone who feeds the hungry and help them feed themselves. Grant that, as bodies are nourished, minds, hearts, and spirits are also fed with the living bread from heaven.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Guide the deliberations and actions of our government leaders. Let your will be done, so your people receive all they need to live in safety. Teach us to feed one another, not only with food that perishes, but also with your imperishable and holy word, and establish your peace in our midst.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
You open your hand and fulfill the desire of every living creature. Please open your hand to bestow health, hope, strength, and guidance upon all whose need is great. This morning we pray especially for the family of Lyle and Sarah Chater, Joyce, Marion B., Marion M., Lois and her family, Juanita, Doreen, Beverly and her family, John and Elmer, Ken and Sheila, Geraldine, Indy, Ed and Jeanette, and the family of Curtis Dirksen. Feed them with faith and fill them with the refreshing waters of your grace and salvation.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
With reverence and affection, we remember before you all our loved ones who have died and are at rest in you. Strengthen bonds of affection with our fellow pilgrims along life's journey. Bring us all, with all whom you have redeemed, into the joy and life you share in union with your Son and the Holy Spirit.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for those named or remembered, and in solidarity with those who have not the freedom to express their concern or celebration for fear of discrimination or condemnation, in all our joys and in all our concerns, may we be ever mindful of the presentness of the sacred among us and to see new possibilities of the now.
Amen.
And together we'll read the collect of the day. Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ fed the hungry with the bread of his life and the word of his kingdom. Renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your true and living bread, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This morning we're using an alternate version of the Lord's Prayer. For those in attendance here, as well as at home who have a copy of today's bulletin, please read with me. All others, please listen to these words. Our Mother, whose body is the earth, sacred is your being, your gardens grow, your will be done in our cities as it is in nature. Thanks be this day for food and air and water. Forgive us our sins against earth as we are learning to forgive one another. And surrender us not unto extinction, but deliver us from our folly. For yours is the beauty and the power and all life, from birth to death, from beginning to end. Amen.
If you have found some of the good bread of Christ here this day, then don't hesitate to share it with others. For this is the bread that increases the more it is given away and nourishes us best in the presence of goodwill and laughter. So go on your way in good spirits, for the best is yet to come. The grace of our Savior, the love of our Creator, and the friendship our enabler, and be with us this day and evermore. Amen. Our closing hymn is 565, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Just a few announcements before we dismiss. One of them, you know, many of you are bidding on our St. Saviour's auction. A lot of action going on again this week. And it closes at 7 o'clock this evening. And a new batch of items will appear next Tuesday morning. The service, as always, will be updated to YouTube later in the day. Also, if you want to meet in person next week, please, as you always do, let Kendra know ahead of time. And please invite friends and neighbors and other members of our parish that would like to join as well. And finally, as I've said for several weeks, if you have no health reason to the contrary, please take the invite to get your vaccinations. So we are the ambassadors of a faith that can shift mountainous obstacles and of a love which increases the more it is given away.
The world awaits us.
Let us get on with it. With God's help, we will. Hallelujah.